This would be the case if the person in question had lost of interest in the earthly world before dying, if all the desires, wishes, and so on linking that individual to the physical existence left behind had been satisfied. But to the extent that this is not the case, what remains of this orientation clings to the soul. To avoid confusion at this point, we must clearly distinguish between something that binds a person to the world in a way that can be resolved in a future incarnation, and something that binds that individual to one particular incarnation, namely the most recent one. In the first case, the situation is resolved by karma, in the second, it can only be discarded by the soul after death. For the human spirit, death is followed by a time in which the soul strips itself of its inclinations toward physical existence so that it can once again obey only the laws of the spirit and soul wills and can set the spirit free. Of course this takes longer in cases where the soul has been more tightly bound to the physical. It takes little time in cases of individuals who have not been very attached to physical life, longer in cases of those whose interests were totally bound up with that life and who therefore still have many desires, wishes and so on present in their souls at death. 20, 21, 114 Theosophy, 22, 23. Gaining an idea of the state in which the soul lives during the time right after death would be easiest to appreciate a fairly crass example, for instance, the pleasure of a gourmet. This pleasure, of course, is not of the body but of the soul, in that both the pleasure and the desire for this pleasure belong to the soul. However, satisfying this desire requires the corresponding bodily organs, palate, taste buds, and so on. After death, the soul does not immediately lose this desire, but the physical organs that used to be the means of satisfying it are no longer there. The person in question then experiences something similar to suffering from a stranger standing anywhere where there is no water for miles around.
Very life, the spirit is much more closely related to the body, to which it is linked only indirectly.
sees its object as dark, and as a result its soul feels hollow and empty, as if it had lost itself. This lasts until the recognition dawns that the true human being is not visible in nature. Thus the effects of this fourth region destroy the illusion of the body itself. The soul learns to no longer perceive its bodily basis as essential, and is purified and carried into the essence of the bodily existence, overcoming that this divine is so strong in the physical world. It can now fully unfold the forces of sympathy, which move outward. The soul has chosen the region itself, as a will, and is ready to pour itself back to the human soul world in general. This higher feeling for nature is among the things that perfectly follow the spirit as it continues its journey, you must first look at the territory it is entering. This is the world of the spirit, and it is so different from the physical world that everything you have to say about it would seem sheer fantasy to those willing to trust only their physical senses. We had to use comparisons and imagery to describe the soul world, and that is even more the case here. Our language, which for the most part serves only the purposes of sense perceptual reality, is not exactly richly endowed with expressions that can be applied directly to us, hungry spirit beings, so it is especially important to think much of what is said here as nothing more than indication. Since everything described here is so different from the physical world, this is the only possible way of depicting it at all. Because of the inadequacy of our language, which is intended for communication in the physical world, the statements being made here can only. 5. An outline of the folk science question, NY, Anthroposophy Press, 1972. The three codes 123. Roughly correspond to actual experience in the spiritual field. It must be emphasized above all that this spiritual world is woven out of the substance that constitutes human thought.
Thank you.
physical worlds that are not endowed with life. The archetypes of minerals are to be found here, and those in plants, but only to the extent that they are purely physical, that is, to the extent that we do not take their inherent life into account. In the same way, we also find the physical forms of animals and human beings here. This is not an exhaustive list of what is to be found in this first region, but only a few illustrative examples. This region constitutes the basic structure of the country of spirit beings, and can be compared to the solid land masses of our physical earth. It is the continental mass of this spirit country. Of course, its relationship to the physical bodily world can be described only by means of comparison. We can get some idea of it as follows. Imagine a finite space filled with a wide variety of physical bodies, then imagine that the physical bodies are drawn and visualized solid spaces of the same shapes in their places. Imagine that what used to be the empty spaces between the bodies is filled with a wide variety of forms that relate to the former bodies in many different ways. This is somewhat similar to how things appear in the lowest region of the world of archetypes. These are beings that are embodied in the physical world exist as hollow spaces here, and the local activity of the archetypes and the spiritual world that goes on in between them. When the time comes for spirit embodiment, the hollow spaces are then filled with matter, so to speak. Everything. It could be likened to the